Good evening, everybody. Welcome to our International Space University Space Studies Program evening panel discussions. I'm John Connolly, director of the 28th Space Studies Program, and I'd like to welcome you all tonight to tonight's event. Our panel tonight looks at the new breed of entrepreneurs that are setting their sights on the stars and challenging the space market that has for so long been dominated by the big boys of space. Our panel tonight represents some of the space professionals who have challenged the business models of the space industry and who have found new, more agile business solutions. Before we begin, I'd like to share a quick thank you to Ohio University, especially Dean Dennis Irwin, for being our host for SSP15. I'd like to thank our space agency partners, NASA's John Glenn Research Center, and our major sponsors, the French Space Agency, CNES, Chinese Aerospace Corporation, European Space Agency, the Indian Space Research Organization, Lockheed Martin Corporation, the Aerospace Corporation, the Boeing Company, the UK Space Agency, Mansat, and the International Institute of Space Commerce. And thanks to all of the ISU and Ohio staff who are making these special evenings possible. And then finally, thanks to our panelists tonight. We're honored that you folks are here and sharing your experiences with us. As we get started, we'd like to remind you all that there will be a question and answer session where you could ask questions directly of our panelists. Please use the microphones that you see on the corners of the auditorium. So now I'd like to introduce our moderator for the evening, Mr. Chris Stott. Chris is the chairman and chief executive officer of Mansat, an orbital frequencies and regulatory services company with clients throughout North America and headquartered on the Isle of Man with offices in London and Houston. Chris is a 1995 graduate of the International Space University's Masters of Space Studies program, the very first one we had in Strasbourg, France, and he's been a member of the ISU faculty since 2003. He served as lecturer, department chair, and recently as member of the ISU Board of Trustees. Chris also serves on the boards of the Society of Satellite Professionals International, the International Institute of Space Commerce, Space Services Incorporated, and Odyssey Moon. Chris is also the current chairman of Mana Energy Foundation and vice chairman of the United Space School Foundation. In November of 2010, Chris was named Celadon Manx Isle of Man Business Person of the Year. Chris left his position as Director of International Commercialization Sales with Lockheed Martin to found Mansat. Prior to his work with Lockheed, he was with Boeing Space and Communications Company, working in international business development. Chris holds a master's degree in space studies from ISU, a degree in American Studies from the University of Kent in Canterbury, and a diploma from the University of California, San Diego. A published author, Chris is also a fellow of the Royal Astronomical Society and the International Institute of Space Law. He's just happens to be married to an astronaut as well, Nicole Stott, and he lives in Houston, Texas, right down the street from me. Please join me in welcoming Mr. Chris Stott.
Thank you. John, thank you very much. I think that's the nicest intro I've ever had, actually. That's very kind. Thank you. Well, ladies and gentlemen, thank you for joining us tonight. We want this to be a fun experience, an interactive experience, where we're going to be talking about really what's fundamentally changing in the world at the moment, this whole space renaissance, this whole next step in the commercialization of space, where we're seeing entrepreneurial space activities. And we are truly very lucky, very blessed to have with us tonight some very unique individuals. We have Jeffrey Manber, CEO of Nanorax, with us tonight. And as we progress in the evening, we're going to tease out their background, their histories, and various things that are happening in their companies at the moment. But Jeff, of course, is also CEO of MiaCore. And Jeff has had an illustrious career at being at the vanguard of pushing those boundaries in space. And not just pushing them, but making them happen. And the company Nanorax today is the largest private user of space station. Tremendous achievement, and achievements that are growing still more. To Jeff's left, we have Michael Potter. Michael is a unique entrepreneur in that he's pretty much done everything. He's founded pan-European telecoms companies back in the 90s, was the first to do that with Esprit Telecom. He has made films about entrepreneurs in space, award-winning, multi-award-winning films, documentary films, Orphans of Apollo. And Michael does a tremendous amount of charitable work as well. He has his own investments, he does a lot of entrepreneurial things, but he's also the executive director and founder of Geeks Without Frontiers, which is leading the world in looking to impact the lives of a billion people in less than 10 years by bringing internet to the rest of the world. Not through satellite constellations, but through village-level Wi-Fi. And to Michael's left on the screen, and kindly joining us from San Francisco, is Dr. Will Marshall, founder and CEO of Planet Labs. A fascinating company, totally unique in what they're doing. It's tremendous. And I say this as someone who works in satellite communications. Will's company has now launched, I think, more satellites than any other satellite operator to date. And they've done so in rapid succession and are really pushing the boundaries of what you can do in space and how you do it. Not so much in how you build your satellites, but more in how you address a market with a unique proposition. And one thing I asked the ISU students to do for tonight, and please, everybody who's here this evening, go look at the TED Talks that these gentlemen have done. Technology, Entertainment, Design, TED. Each one of these guys has done amazing TED Talks. Truly astounding. And with great reference and deference to Jeff and to Mike, I must say that I think Will got the fastest standing ovation at TED Global in Rio that I've ever seen in my life. And it was tremendous. He did a fantastic job. And so you've got people who are pushing the boundaries, have pushed them, are continuing to push them. And what I'd like to do is just lead in, and Will, if you can hear me, I'd like to ask you the first question and sort of have you sort of lead the discussion, is that not everybody chooses to be an entrepreneur in life. And it was that moment, what was it that led you to make that choice to, you know, you were at NASA, and to go form a company, to take your idea forward? What was that defining moment? Was there a specific moment in time, or was it something you'd always wanted to do? What brought you to Planet Labs?
I'm having a slight problem hearing you. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you, yes.
And can people in the audience hear me okay?
Yes.
Great. Well, technology is working at least partially. Yeah, I basically heard the question of why did I leave NASA to start Planet Lab. Essentially, we have been pioneering at NASA low-cost satellites for doing science and exploration missions, and we thought about a number of applications of utilizing sort of consumer electronics. In particular, we started launching these phones into space, literally smartphones, and seeing if they would work in space. We saw that they did work in space, and then we realized that there was lots of things that could be done if the satellite cost was so much lower. Our first idea was to do Earth imaging, and in particular, by launching a whole lot of web cameras, if you like, around the Earth, we could do something that no one had done before, which is take regular imagery of the entire planet. Led us to thinking about all the applications of that imagery, and the applications were a lot in the space of commercial uses and a lot in the space of humanitarian uses. In the humanitarian uses, there were things like agriculture and deforestation and tracking the ice caps and helping people in disaster response, like in the situation of Nepal right now. And in the commercial bucket, there were things like consumer mapping, finance, insurance, forest management, and things like this. But because they were mainly commercial and humanitarian applications, and NASA's really focused on science and exploration, we thought it would be best to do that outside of NASA, so we left NASA to start Planet Labs for that reason. Does that make sense?
It does. No, thank you. And that's what we're trying to get at tonight, is why you made the leap. And Michael and Jeff, please, chip in with Will here. Why did you guys decide to not do the usual, to have your own companies, to work with teams, to do something different?
So I went to International Space University, first class. I'm the dinosaur. I'm class of 1988. And it was kind of an interesting experience because I was working at a foreign policy think tank in Washington, D.C. And someone walked in the door and said, hey, we have a free scholarship to go to the International Space University at MIT. And I'm like, okay, I'll do it. You know, that sounds like a lot of fun. So I think a lot of the students that go to ISU are already pretty flexible people. They're pretty bright people. And in a sense, they have a lot of what it takes to be entrepreneurial. I think one of the challenges, and particularly in the first many years of ISU, is that a lot of people attracted to space also work for large organizations. Many of them work for large organizations, for space agencies and for governments and for contractors. And so while people are smart and they're curious, and because they're dealing with leading edge technologies, which sometimes are logical ways to get into entrepreneurial companies, that wasn't quite the dynamic early on at ISU. But I think for me, personally, when I got out of ISU, I did not go back to the foreign policy think tank, so I had my first kind of professional space job. I was an outer space consultant, which was a lot of fun. But then at some point, I decided that I could write reports all the time for NASA, and those could be put on a shelf, and then NASA will never listen to it, or I could try to have an impact. But I have to say that you know, going back to Chris's comment about that specific moment where you become an entrepreneur, it's kind of a scary moment, because in academia there's a lot of protection, there's a lot of it has a certain stability and a certain logic to it. So that's also a lot of people with ISU, that's always an option. Many people could easily go down an academic track as well. And so I sometimes think about the military strategist Sun Tzu. And Sun Tzu argued that the best way to motivate a military is to line up the entire military against the edge of a cliff. And that way they can only fight one direction. And I think an entrepreneur, either on purpose or by accident, ends up in that situation. And that was the specific moment that I just said, you know what, I've painted myself into a corner. I want to run this business. I feel strong about running this business. And then that was the moment that I only had one direction to go. And I think it's important because it really forces a certain discipline and a certain focus. Mm-hmm.
Jeff, what brought you?
Michael was the producer and director of this wonderful film, The Orphans of Apollo, which talks about a generation, which includes mine, and was really had the rub.
The audio.
Where's your microphone, Jeff?
I'm sorry?
I think we've lost your microphone. Oh, I did not ask where your microphone's been.
Sorry about that. Okay.
So we can put things in space.
Okay, yeah. For me, it was Michael had produced and directed this film, Orphans of Apollo, which is about, in essence, a generation of us that were disappointed when the American government sort of stopped the exploration of space. And I think for me, there was always a growing frustration that space was moving slower than anything else we knew in our society. And you see the innovation that takes place in aviation and computers and telephones and how movies are distributed. And then there was space, had a rocket ship. And if we're lucky, the rocket ship would take off once every 7 months. And there was just, for me, this frustration. And for me personally, it was not the moment where to decide to be an entrepreneur. It was the moment I decided I would go work with the Russians. And, it was the early 89, 90, 91, and at that time, the Russians had a commercial space program. And I used to say in the 90s that if you want to work with the socialists in space, you'd work with NASA. And if you wanted to work with the capitalists, you work with the Russians. And that may not be so true today, but it was true in 91, 92, 93. And that was a really tough choice. And I began working with a Russian organization called Energia, and helped privatize their organization. We began doing the first non-professionals to go on the station, the first film, the commercials, milk commercials on the station, and people laughed. And they said, that's not space. That's not space. And to me, it was and is space, if you can make space any other place to do business. And so it wasn't for me being an entrepreneur, it was, did I have the guts to sit at a table opposite my friends on the American side? And that's where you really weigh who you are and what your motivation and how far you're committed to go.
So what's the what's been the most surprising thing about being CEO of your own company?
The most surprising thing about what?
Oh, being the CEO and founder of a company, being the boss.
I'm only catching 64% of what you're saying. Is what's surprising about being a CEO of what?
Your company, of Planet Labs, of being a CEO.
When I was at NASA, we had done been doing these small spacecraft missions, and already by then I had spent a lot of my time filling out forms so that the team under me didn't have to do those forms and actually could do engineering. At some level, I see my role here somewhat similarly. I have to do a lot of things that I think are to try and help make sure that the team that I really see myself working for has everything it needs to do their day-to-day jobs, and that is engineering and the science that's necessary. What's the most surprising thing? Sometimes I'm surprised at how easy it is to get investment. That's been surprising. Other things I'm surprised about is just the sheer complexity of the systems engineering project we've undertaken, and how difficult it is. But perhaps the most surprising thing for me is how we continue to attract really great people and what they manage to do. Somebody asked me yesterday what the most amazing thing that I think Planet Labs excels at, and I was really having a hard time because there's about a dozen things that we've done that no other company or entity has done in the world, and I was trying to think why, and I can only think of the fact that we've got a great team of people that really care about our mission, and our mission is one that transcends just about making money. It's about using satellites to help humanity. And that's what really attracts great people, and the great people are what enables us to do great things, and that constantly inspires me.
No, very cool. Thank you. Michael, Jeff?
Yeah, I think that running an entrepreneurial business is a little bit like a political campaign, and so in the early stages of a political campaign, people are tired and worn out, but people are inspired because they want to win the election, and there's a lot of energy and a lot of enthusiasm. And then eventually the political candidate wins the election, and sometimes you almost need a different team to run the government than the team that put the politician in office. And so I think that entrepreneurial companies, they go through different stages, and the early stages are fun, they're dynamic, they can be tiring, but it's immensely creative. But when you get to a certain element of success, then that's when a lot of the disciplines that are very different disciplines, very different survival skills that were required to make the early stage of the entrepreneurial company successful. And then you get into the part of the management level and stage where people have to do employee reviews on a quarterly basis, mm-hmm. and there's shareholders involved. And sometimes if it's a publicly traded company, there's disciplines about reporting requirements. So, I prefer to look at it at different stages, and there's different talents that are required at different stages. And so I think it's funny because, a lot of people with the International Space University, they might have ideas. So they're on the earlier side. They're not on the operational side. They're not, how do we go out and hire 10, 20, 30, 40 people? But that's, so that becomes, sort of a different set of challenges. And I think that management, I think Will made a great point about, he in a sense plays interference so that he can be a great coach, so he can allow his team to win. And that's a great attitude. And we're missing that in the government space agencies. I think that's what Silicon Valley is great at, is putting together teams where we try to let the best ideas win out. So, if you look at a lot of traditional bureaucracies, sometimes someone says, I've been working here 30 years, so let's just do it my way. And then somebody comes in and says, hey, I actually happen to have a PhD, and I got it 2 years ago, and I can tell you that it's 5 times more efficient. Well, we want those ideas to win out. We don't want these kind of legacy ideas. And I think that the reason why a lot of us got involved with entrepreneurial companies is that we didn't see the government being able to provide solutions. So we feel this this challenge, but also sometimes a burden about how do we solve these problems more creatively that big, well-funded agencies are often not able to do.
Hey, Michael, I just wanted to add, I completely agree with your point about the early stages, later stages, or different stages needing different sorts of skill sets. In this early stage, you want this creative, we're trying to design new spacecraft that do new things that no one's done before. And then later on, now we're trying to execute on contracts that we've received and just perfect the spacecraft, make them slightly more efficient, but optimizing versus the initial creativity is very different. And then becoming a sort of operational business is very different from a bunch of people in a garage and who each do everything. The different people at different stages is very much resonates with my experience.
For me, talk about a micro and on a macro. On the micro level, to follow through on what Michael and Will have been talking about, a few weeks ago I dialed in to our internal conference call, and there was a bunch of people on, and I said, which call is this? And they said, this is the management meeting. I'm like, I'm management. You know, I didn't know about this. Well, now we have a Nanorax. We've grown to about 40, 45 people now. And so they have their own meetings, of which I don't take part in. And to follow through on something Will said, one of the most rewarding things for me at Nanorax, we own our own hardware on the space station. We're the only company that does that. We offer services on the space station. And so we have a diversity of customers, everything from high schools around the world to German Space Agency, to NASA, to Planet Labs, to other folks. And one of the most rewarding things is jumping in a day from having an hour meeting on how you solve a problem for an education or a high school that's trying to do something in space, and then we're dealing with the always pushing the envelope with Planet Labs on what NASA's comfortable doing, and that takes up a lot of time on how you move the needs of a Planet Labs or someone else through the NASA system. And so one of the most rewarding things for us at Nanorax is with each customer, we think we're changing the industry. You know, with each customer that we've flown, something changes up there. You know, whether it's a new student that's been touched, whether it's a valuation for a company that's been increased, we really see ourselves as enablers for our customers. And so for us, the challenge is how many customers can we get up there? And we're not talking about even the cash flow or the profit mode of it. You know, hey, we just introduced Peru to space a few months ago. Well, that's cool. And hey, we just introduced Lithuania. We flew their first payloads. Well, that's cool. What more can we do? And so I think the most surprising thing for me is still how young this industry is, how few real ventures there are. Planet Labs, you know, there's SpaceX, there's a handful of companies that are what we call new space that are really changing the way we do space. And that's really still surprises me that just to speak personally, that there's so few people copying what we're doing after 4 or 5 years of our doing it. And the reason is because it's tough. But that's been the most surprising thing, and the most rewarding is that what we've been doing for our customers.
Well, no, I'm just speaking from Mansat's point of view. I mean, we've been in business, 15 years? We're still, I think, the only commercial company that helps people through the ITU process. And we've grown, and we're hiring. When we talk to the students about this today, we're hiring. Sometimes attracting the people is the best thing, yeah. Like you're saying. Surrounding yourself with the most incredible people, yeah. And delegating and letting them do their job. And you get the most amazing results out of people. And we were talking today, I think one of the surprising things I found as a CEO when I started this was just, A, how many people told me not to do it. This is, you know, back a long time ago. But then realizing that the only limits that we have upon ourselves are the ones we place upon ourselves. So it's going to sound really, compared to these guys, really quite small, but it was getting in the first week of work and realizing I didn't have to ask permission to go buy stamps. I'd been working at a major aerospace corporation before that. We had to fill out forms in triplicate to do anything. And it was that moment when I went, wait a minute, I don't need permission. I'm a startup. We can actually go hire people. I don't need HR. I can actually just start doing things. And I think that's that magic moment when you realize that by force of will and personality and your business plan and working with your shareholders and funders and customers, when those first customers come through the door and you start providing services to them, it can be the most rewarding thing you do.
I'd like to add also that one of the things I think is absolutely necessary is blind faith. And when we started Nanoracks in 2009, it was U.S. policy that the space station would be deorbited in 2015. And so the smart money, the smart people in the industry knew that the space station had a very, very limited life and no one was willing to invest. And we were willing to invest our own funds in the belief that we were simply not going to allow the station to come down. And so there has to, sometimes you gain market share or you gain an advantage, or you gain a company just because you have a blind faith. There was no consultant I could have turned to in 2009 who would have said, yes, go for it. Maybe they'll change their mind on the station. But we just felt it was true. So, you know, you talk about one of the biggest surprises is how much you have to rely on yourself. And it's not consultants, and it's not outside people. It's something that you have to feel inside of you.
Well, that's it. If you're not willing to make the change and be the change, it won't happen.
Yeah. And just to reinforce Jeff's point about this leap of faith, I mean, one of the probably most extraordinary business leaps of faith that has ever been taken in human history was Elon Musk. And so Elon started building a rocket with his own resources without any contracts. And eventually they retired the space shuttle. A lot of people thought the space shuttle won't be retired. There'll be some congressman, be some senator somewhere that'll make it impossible to ever retire the space shuttle. And when Elon first got started, a lot of people at NASA felt threatened and they felt it was very awkward to have him around. There weren't a lot of clear rules and laws about how to incorporate him. And I have to tell you, one of the most powerful moments in my experience with the new space movement was I was at one of Elon's launches shortly after the shuttle had been retired. And previously, Kennedy Space Flight Center had been a little bit uncomfortable with Elon launching there. And suddenly, the gift shop at Kennedy Space Flight Center no longer had tons and tons of shuttle paraphernalia. It was all SpaceX paraphernalia. And basically, thousands of jobs at Kennedy Space Flight Center were all thanks to Elon Musk. Yeah. And so to imagine the leaps of faith and almost experiencing personal bankruptcy to be committed to an idea that strongly, it's incredibly unusual. Things could have easily have gone another way, but they went the right way. And it's probably one of the most powerful moments in the new space movement.
Well, and there's something all three of you have touched on tonight, and that is space station, the International Space Station. We've now had a human presence in space since the year 98?
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
And why is space station important for commerce?
I'll go first, Will, because most of my career has been working on space stations. To me, we can't really move out into space without owning, controlling, being on real estate. And, I wish we were on the moon. I wish we were on Mars. And for me, for the next 5 or 10 years, it's space stations. It's space platforms. It's important to be on them, whether they're manned or, there's human crew or non-human crew, because there's different things you can do, different things you can dream about. The satellites are wonderful. Earth observation is incredibly important, but as humanity itself, when you live and you work and you interact in a room or in an office or in a house, that to me is what a space station is. And it's a place, if it's got a crew, it's a place where people live, they get bored, they think of ideas. Our hope is that as we move more and more away from government control of the space stations, you'll see creativity. You'll see new ideas come out. So for me, this is all about taking, the next steps after just visiting and to more and more start living. So for me, it's both business, but it's also philosophical as well in that sense.
Mm-hmm. Will, any? I mean, I know Planet Labs, you guys use space station occasionally, and...
Any Planet Labs perspective on what about the space station?
Oh, is space station important to commerce in the future?
It depends on what time scale you think about. Right now, it's very important. For us, it's been a mechanism for getting access to space in cooperation with Jeff from Nanorax. And it's been so because ISS has demanded a certain supply rate of rockets going up to resupply it. And we have utilized excess capacity on those rockets, essentially, to get our satellites in orbit. So it's been a bit of a stepping stone for us. In the long run, of course, there's question marks about that. I mean, you know, overall, I mean, I think one always has to remember the big picture perspective regarding the ISS is that it's a political project, a project that was started to try and seek to form more cooperation between two superpowers and to try and reduce the probability of scientists going and working on missiles and nuclear weapons instead doing a peaceful project. I mean, it was really a political game. And so I don't think you can think of the cost of it as justifiable in the sense of science, but it can for these political ends. I think it's great that it's around to help us and various other commercial companies get going. I think it's great that it's around to do certain science. These are more or less offshoots of an asset that politicians have put a lot of money in for very different other reasons.
Cool. Michael, any comments?
Yeah, I mean, I would just agree with everything that Will has said. I mean, most people may not fully appreciate it, but the International Space Station is essentially one of the biggest arms control projects that's ever been done. There's more money, $200 billion has gone into International Space Station. That's a fully loaded cost of transportation and everything. And that's really, if you look at that in relationship to the Marshall Plan in Europe after World War II, it's a huge, huge figure, $200 billion for arms control after the end of the Cold War. But I think that one of the interesting things, if you read the current NASA strategic plan, they say that the space station is the centerpiece of what NASA is doing right now. It's the most important thing that NASA is doing right now. But at the same time, NASA is getting ready to dump it in the ocean in 2024. Now, there are going to be other providers. There'll be other alternative, other options that NASA will probably commercially have access to at much more efficient cost. But I think the most important question for this room, and particularly space university students, is trying to figure out that takes place in 2024. So what are the challenges and opportunities that will be created by this, and particularly commercially after 2024? And I think there's a whole ecosystem available. And again, I don't see governments really having a clear strategy for that, but I think businesses can develop those clear strategies.
Yeah, Jeff.
And I just want to push back a little bit. Chris's question wasn't about the ISS, it was about space stations.
Right.
And so, you know, let me say that I think the government, international government, the governments that are involved today in the International Space Station, Russia, Europe, Canada, Japan, and the States, have been making it clear that after 2024, the governments won't be involved in low Earth orbit and space. And so that's incredibly exciting to me because, you know, if we're having for the first, maybe the second time, more in the communication satellites where, you know, the U.S. government, Department of Defense said, we won't build our own communication satellites, we'll have the private sector build in and we'll be customers. And so I'm beginning to see that and hear that from government officials all over the world saying, you know, after ISS, we just want to be a customer. And so for me personally, that's very exciting. And I think that, as Michael is saying, you know, as students, all of you interested in space, here you have an entire area of space, low Earth orbit, where the governments are pretty much saying, you know, most of the governments, we won't compete, we'll be a customer. And we do hope that out of that will come an ecosystem. You'll have the continuation for a while of the U.S. government providing cargo there. There'll be at least two U.S. crewed missions coming up with Boeing and SpaceX. You'll have Russia having manned transportation. You'll have China doing manned transportation. Okay, maybe Blue Origin. Maybe Jeff Bezos will be getting to orbit by then. Okay, you got five ways to get humans to space, and you're not competing against NASA anymore? I like that. And so that, to me, is one of the exciting things for entrepreneurs as you look a few years out.
So ladies and gentlemen, we have people here who aren't just at the envelope. They're the very tip of the spear, making things happen, changing commerce, changing things for all of us in the human race, seriously. And you now have the chance to ask them questions. I've kind of warmed them up a little bit.
Yeah.
And the idea is that they don't bite, it's okay, they're really nice people.
Does it hurt on the spear and the edge?
Yes, the tip of the spear, yes. It depends who's prodding you, it's not so bad. So, ladies and gentlemen, if you have questions, please ask. I'd like you to just say your name and then enunciate and make sure we can all hear, and especially, you know, for Will, very kindly joining us from San Francisco. So,
hi, guys. Thanks. My name's Jonathan from Ireland. I'm wondering, is there any area for very small companies in the space sector? So maybe 3 or 4 people, because I've heard a lot about entrepreneurs and millions of dollars being raised, but is there any kind of smaller areas where companies can get involved?
Will, you want to take that?
Yeah, I think there are lots of ways in which very small companies can get involved. I mean, there's lots of components of spacecraft that a small specialized company could produce that lots of people would be able to use. There's lots of specialized tools that we could be put on top of various services. Like we're building this Earth imaging capability, but you know, you might produce a little app that does fire detection on top of that, and then alerts fire departments or a zillion other things that you could utilize that data for. And those could be done in small teams. Does that answer your question? I'm not quite sure if that answers your question.
For us at Nanorax, we sometimes make a conscious decision that we can't try and produce in-house all the hardware that we know we need. And we do that not only for the bandwidth, but also we want creativity. We want people who are not connected to us to come in and say, like, for example, we have little cubes called nanolabs. And we do biological experiments inside, and we don't make them in our shop. We have 3 or 4 companies, we have a university that makes those nanolabs for us. So there's growing amount of opportunities for small companies to start out, I think.
Yeah,
I think one of the most important features of the new space movement is that it's possible to have a very low cost barrier to entry. So if you look back, you know, 10 years ago, 20 years ago, if you didn't have billions in the bank, you couldn't even think about space. But now it's possible to do something like Made in Space, 3D printing. Yeah. And I think that if you look also when Facebook got started, a lot of people said that's impossible. You can't take on Google. You can't take on the giants. You're just Facebook. But now people can go out and they can lease supercomputer time through Amazon. And so essentially for those types of social network, there's zero cost to entry, and I think with space there'll always be some, you know, cost to enter, but it's dropping every single day.
Well, exactly. I mean, you're almost in the golden age, because you know when we were starting out, we couldn't do the things that we could do 20 years ago, 10 years ago, and now, thanks to the agencies and thanks to some very nice billionaires who are spending billions of dollars, they're doing all the heavy lifting. No pun intended. They're putting these incredible assets there for us to use. It goes beautiful space station. You know, it's an incredible laboratory in space, which is just pretty much open for business. And you don't have to be a space agency or a massive corporation to use it. You can be down at the high school level. You can test your ideas. And it's that golden age. It's a real shift. And there's one thing we just touched upon. Michael and Will, you both touched on this, and Jeff as well. This change in technology, this exponential change. I mean, Will, you held up a cell phone, a smartphone, that you've flown in space and done amazing things with. And this whole change in technology, the rapid pace of change, the exponential change, and how things are getting cheaper and easier.
And if I can just add to that, Chris, I would say that there's a couple of reasons why it's suddenly possible for smaller teams to be able to do things. It's a little bit to do with launch access, although I actually think that that's not the dominant factor. I think the dominant factors are the underlying technology enabling things to be much smaller. So the thing that Planet Labs has benefited from is making a 100x reduction in the size of satellites for the same capability. And that makes a big difference to what one is able to do. Rather than having more access to launch, it's more about that. And then the other wave of things that's happened is that, as you were referring to AWS, the ability to utilize other cloud compute software systems to process your data means that a once completely impossible task is now something that a few people can do. That combination is essentially learning, the space sector learning to follow rather than take the lead. So this is something that we struggled with a lot at the beginning, because everyone told us, no, you have to do space this way. You have to use these plume rooms. You have to test this technology in space first. It has to be red hard. It has to be X, Y, Z. We went to these lists of hundreds of things that we were told that we had to do, otherwise it couldn't go to space. We literally did none of them. None at all, and it worked just fine. The satellites worked just fine without any of that testing, without clean rooms, without red hard. And it was because the space sector had been used to doing, having to build a lot of that capability from scratch itself. And it was partly because of a different risk attitude. But we are now leveraging the billions of dollars that are spent in consumer electronics, the billions of dollars that Jeff Bezos is spending in cloud compute infrastructure. We're leveraging those things that are outside the space industry to get more bang for the buck with our space projects. And I think that's what is the underlying change that enables these things to be done with so many few people, so a fewer people.
No, exactly. I mean, it's the age of opportunity almost.
Right. Yeah, I was going to add to what Will's saying, and then we'll take the next question. I think NASA was surprised by the power of miniaturization. And when we first went to NASA and said, we want our standard laboratory to be a nano lab that's 10 centimeters by 10 centimeters by 10 centimeters, they laughed at us. And now we have customers such as Valley Christian High School in San Francisco and San Jose that are leasing out. They buy a nano lab from us, and then they divide it in four. And they have quality research taking place in a quarter of a nano lab. And it's due to miniaturization. And it's a sophisticated research.
That's brilliant. They haven't trademarked that, have they? I might just have to borrow that. That was really, that's great, a market within a market.
But it's advanced, like Will is saying, it's advances in technology. It took a lot of folks by surprise in the standard industry, and there's a lot more that can be done. It's Moore's Law in space. Everything's, whether it's 3D printing, robotics, circuit boards, the satellites that Planet Labs is doing, it's all changing now.
Well, and you said Jeff said something before, we got together and had a chat before, and you said there was a really valuable lesson learned that you have to remind yourself of, and that you've spent so much time working to make the change happen.
Yes. This is off message a little bit, but this is a fascinating time to be in the business. And one of the strongest self-criticisms I have of myself is that I don't recognize totally, it's hard for me to accept how much has changed now. And sometimes people in my company or some of the people we're working with will come in and say, well, we can do this now. And I go, wait. And then I realize, no, there's very few institutional barriers. There's liquidity today. If you have a good idea, for the first time in my career, you can go out. I mean, Will said, he's surprised how easy it is to raise capital now. That never existed before. And so for me, one of the toughest things is recognizing that it's a different industry than it was even 10 years ago, where there were very few people trying to do what we're doing today, and there were so many people opposed. There's still people opposed. There's still people just upset that space is becoming just another place to do business, but it's rapidly changing.
Yeah. I think one of the points that I was going to make about we're talking about smaller workforces, dynamic, flex manufacturing standards, miniaturization. And I think one of the challenges is that in many countries, space agencies and space exploration is still seen as an important jobs program. And so how are governments going to reconcile, you know, jobs programs with exactly the opposite, which is like, you know, basically a small team of people, 10 people or 15 people in a university who can do amazing stuff. And governments are thinking, we could really employ 1,000 people or 2,000 if we could just do heavy, expensive, billion-dollar projects. And so at some point, those things have to be reconciled.
Yeah. It's the edgy. Go ahead, Brooke.
And Chris, maybe we should take another question. We're speaking too much. I'm not hearing
enough. True, I was going to say.
I have a question that I think, my name is Remy. I come from France. I have a question, I think, from Jeffrey. Since your TED talk was about the open source space revolution, and I'm into the open source, I like it, I love it, and I want to know, how do you think if after 2024 there is a commercial market on the ISS, how open source and the community could come into play? Yeah, what do you think could happen then?
What will happen after 2024, Jimmy?
Or even other projects you have with the open source community?
Yeah, I think that clearly, first, thank you. And I think clearly, first, let's look at the political. The political situation is that no nation will surrender low Earth orbit now. They want a presence, but they don't want to do it themselves anymore. And so for me, there's what that tells me is that Europe, Russia, America, China, will continue to have a presence in low Earth orbit, but most of those nations, including China, will more and more go the commercial pathway. So I just see it becoming more and more as a regular place to do business. We have people like Paul Allen at Vulcan, who has said one of his goals is to make sure there's a robust low Earth orbit filled with space commerce. And so for me, it's very interesting things you can be doing with satellites, with platforms, manned space stations, hotels. It's going to be a very exciting time, I think. And it won't be 2024. It won't be a switch, you know, on and off. It'll start to happen in the next few years as big customers say, I don't want to go on the ISS. That has a provision. It's ending 2024. I want my own platform. And so we're getting into a very interesting time now.
Hi, I'm here. My name is Jacqueline from the U.S. I was born in Peru, so I'm glad you mentioned the Chasqui satellite. Two questions. First, if they put the ISS for sale, would you bid for it? And the second question is, if I want to start my company and I don't have any money, you're mentioning that now it's easier to get some funding, but I know it requires a lot of work, but would you recommend maybe working at a full-time position or company and maybe do this as a part-time, or what would be your recommendation on that side?
There's a lot of talk in Washington about what do you do with the ISS come 2024, and a lot of folks have said, you know, why doesn't the private sector just buy it? Well, unfortunately, it was built as a government facility. Mm-hmm. And I'll sure take something built by the commercial sector about 2022 that's brand new and is cost efficient than something built by a League of Nations with 1980s technology. And so it's not a knock on the ISS, but it is what it is. And it's old. And especially by 2024, it'll be older. So no, I don't have an interest in that. And so. But I'll leave to others on how best you can raise money, or was that the question? How best? Well, since Will,
yeah, it's so easy.
Yeah, it's so easy to raise money. She was asking, how can she raise money?
Was this about the second question, basically?
Yes, second question. It was about the sale of ISS to commercial parties, and I think also a question about raising money for new ideas.
Yeah, I'm not sure I understand the nuance of the first question, but on the second question, I actually recommend getting going on a project in your spare time. I mean, you were mentioning whether to do it spare time versus full time. I would do it in your spare time until it gets to a point where it's got critical momentum to go beyond that. So we were building our satellites in our garage at the same time as working at NASA. We were just doing it on nights and weekends. And then at some point, it was just obvious that we needed to be full time on it. And the other forcing function, to put yourself in a corner a little bit, like Michael was talking about earlier, we had actually put a deposit down on a launch vehicle that we patently couldn't pay for, but we put the deposit down on it. And then when it came to the bigger checks that we had to write for the launch vehicle, well, we better go and get some bloody money for it. There's nothing better than committing yourself like that to forcing you to go and raise some money. And I sort of highly recommend that. When I was in undergrad, I would do this a lot. I always liked to go to the scientific conferences, I went to Russia to see the space industry around there on this course that Bauman put together. And, you know, I commit myself to that, pay for the ticket somehow on a credit card, and then realize that I haven't got that money, and then go and work for it or go and ask professors for that money because it was, I thought, educational and so forth. But there's nothing better than committing yourself to it. So I would start on your nights and weekends and evolve, and I would commit yourself to it 100% financially, and then eventually you have to go and get money. And vis-a-vis raising money, I have a zillion things to share. I could actually send you guys, if anyone's interested, a little sort of 12 cheetah points on raising money. But the key things include talking only to the decision makers in venture capital firms. You've got to be completely different from everyone else, just not just doing a slide deck, but we would just go along and put a satellite on the table and say, this is what we're building. We're going to put lots of these in space, and this is why it's going to help the world. And you know, you don't need to follow some sort of standard routine. Standing out is more important. And there's lots of other tidbits that I could share an actual document. I mean, I could go through it now, but I think it's a bit too long potentially for one question.
No, Will, please send it. I think you've got a very receptive audience. Please do share the document at some point with the students. That'd be fantastic.
It's called the 12 D's of raising dough, and I wrote it about a year ago because everyone around here is asking me all the time, how the hell did you raise so much money? And I was like, well, it's actually quite simple. Here's the formula.
From Will Marshall himself, it's fantastic. Thanks, Will. Very cool. Keep going with the questions.
My name is Adam. Over here. Hi, I'm from Canada, and my question is for everyone. And the question is, once the market for Earth imaging and for like orbital research and telecommunications is saturated, say 15, 20 years, what is the next new growth area for new space, or new space, whatever it'll be?
Well, I have an answer to that. I mean, firstly, I think there are very many different things in each of those buckets, and a lot of things that are that make that saturation point quite far out. So I mean, for example, in Earth imaging, we're doing this whole scanning of the Earth on a regular basis, but there's also pointing and shooting at higher resolution, and there's lots of other wavelengths, there's lots of other temporal and spatial resolutions to tap into, and there's, within each of those, there's an extraordinarily large number of markets. Then in each of those other areas, like communications, there's an equivalent. All that's to say that I think, by and large, there's a gigantic untapped market here. It's largely a green field of possibilities, held back by what has been, I think, relatively little innovation over the last 20 years in the space sector. And so suddenly this ability to use these consumer electronics and so forth has brought down the barrier so much that suddenly a lot of other things are capable. And so I believe those markets are huge, and we're not going to see the limit of them very soon. But when we do, I do think that there are other applications that are going to come to the fore. I mean, I think I think beyond Earth imaging, there's also going to be active imaging like radar. People will get into that. People will get into better navigation satellites, like a better version of GPS that works in downtown cities better. You could see people maybe even doing personal satellites. You could see lots of other things. I mean, the areas that governments have done satellites to date, you know, really fold us into five categories. And I think that there are probably other categories that we haven't thought of yet. We always think about at Planet Labs that the best application of taking an image every day of the whole planet has probably not been thought of yet, which is one of the strong reasons we want to put all the data online for everyone to have at it and see what applications they came up with. Similarly, if you bring the cost down and the capabilities up per kilogram of devices in space, you're going to change the landscape of possibilities in terms of what can be done with satellites in space beyond and above those five key things that people have done in space to date. So I think there's going to be a lot of possibilities, and it's a lot to do with our imagination.
And you know, and I think also what you're seeing too, when you talk about markets, like Will is saying, is untapped demand. Satellites. Every time we build them, we think we're building a huge geostationary satellite, and we already have to stop planning the next one because they start filling up. This whole, the Internet of Everything, personal data clouds, the iPhone radically changed how we use communications in the world. And just like building a new road around a city to ease congestion, every time we do it, it fills up. And I think we've got this huge demand for communications, huge demand for everything. But also, I mean, space tourism is 20 years old or more. The first guys flew on Mir. And you've got very different markets happening. I mean, the work that Nanorax is doing as well, I mean, opening up new opportunities. So the actual promise of space that we've always talked about, we've always talked about manufacturing in space, protein crystal growth, all the way through to material sciences, 3D printing. That in itself is opening up. We're just basically creating the tools to create these new endeavors. And it's almost like having a crystal ball. You could almost, what's going to change and the things that are going to happen in the next few years are remarkable and stunning. And things that we can't even think of. I mean, there's going to be just a huge revolution in technology through this opening up of the space frontier.
We're not in the satellite business, but traditionally in the space station business, the dream of NASA has been to use microgravity for new processes and new, biopharmaceutical. At Nanorax, as we look out, when we look 5 years out, we have two teams. One looking at how microgravity might change some processes, but the other team is looking at taking cutting-edge technology on the ground, putting it on a platform, and what could we do? And we're actually seeing a lot more innovation in markets. If you had sophisticated 3D printers and you had robotics sitting on a platform, so we're always constantly looking at what will be the markets 5 years out, and is it the traditional way that microgravity will change things? There may be some breakthroughs there, or is it that as advances coming out of Silicon Valley and Frankfurt and Tokyo and these things are coming out, they're just incredible. You know, if we put those things in space on a platform, what can you do? So it never ends. It never ends, the thought process.
I'm right in thinking that some of the best 3D printers operate in vacuum?
We don't know yet.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So it's really, it's what you guys do. It's what you students do. I mean, you know, it really is this huge future at your fingertips for you to go do something and change the world with. It's incredible. Next question. No pressure, by the way.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Anushree. I'm from Canada. And so being an entrepreneur and starting your own company is certainly not an easy job. So my question to you is, how comfortable are you with failure? And what are some of the failures you faced during your journey? And what measures do you undertake in order to overcome that hurdle?
I think I have failed the most here. I think I'm the expert on failing. There's two types of failure. There's failing early on privately. And I led a company, as Mike was saying, called Mir Corp. And we leased the Russian space station Mir. and we failed in front of the entire world, okay? Relatives read about it, everybody calls you up and says, you know, why are you failing? But you know, I'll say it falls down to cultural, okay? First, personal, but let me speak first about culturally. In America, I think one of the reasons we are where we are today is failure is okay. Okay, failure is a learning process. I find with many of my colleagues in Europe and certainly in Asia, failure is an embarrassment. Okay, failure is not something that, you know, you've let down your relatives, you've let down your colleagues. When Mirkov failed, my Russian friends and colleagues took me aside and said, you know, we're sorry, we're never going to hear from you again. I mean, this is over, you failed. And yet, in America, it's viewed that you have experience. So it doesn't make failure any easier. But first off, I've seen in my career, I've seen the different ways that cultures and countries approach failure, and I find that fascinating. And we seem to be far more willing in North America to take that risk than in a lot of the other societies. Personally, it's tough. Okay, personally, it's extremely difficult to see your world dissolve. The thing that makes you get up, the thing that you have commitments. And that's another thing about North America against a lot of other cultures. In my society, if an entrepreneur says, in 5 years I'll be at this growth rate and we don't make it, they understand. In many cultures I work in, they say, well, you're not a person of your word. Man, when you start doing this sort of thing internationally, the way different people look at entrepreneurial ventures is so fascinating. And really, it's the North American, or dare I say, the Anglo-Saxon model, which is far more willing to say, you're not a bad person if you lose other people's money. It's a very interesting concept, okay? In most of the world, you lose someone's money, you're in trouble. And in the entrepreneurial spirit of the Anglo-Saxon world, I guess it is, that is what you sign up for. And so for me, my career, it's always been intellectualizing it and looking at the way the culture views it. And then secondly, the personal, and that's the subject over beer or wine. It's tough. It's tough. I mean, you do feel you let your friends down. You let everybody down.
It is one of the strongest human emotions. And, yeah. And people don't like to... fail. It's not fun. But I think that in our life we all take risk, and you know, people get risk in relationships, and those relationships don't work out, and we get upset, and then we kind of move on. And I think there's a little bit of that in the business world. We certainly don't set out to fail, but then we get kicked around, and we get some scar tissue, and hopefully we're a slightly better person. Hopefully we've learned, so there's been some teachable moments, and we've learned some lessons. So I think that, it's interesting because, the famous quote from NASA, which is, you know, failure is not an option, that's probably one of the most expensive, yeah, difficult, yeah, inefficient, yeah, phrases that has been taken too literally. And so we have to be responsible, we have to take, kind of educated, responsible risk. But sometimes things do go wrong. And, you know, it's a huge disappointment. And, you know, Richard Branson with Virgin Galactic, huge, huge setback. And there's, you know, and not only that, before that, we had in the development with Burt Rutan, they had an explosion on the ground and they lost people. So that's when the stakes are incredibly high and nobody wants to lose human life. And the thing that only makes it slightly easier when it's cash and not human life, of course you feel bad, but it happens. And I guarantee you, any successful entrepreneur on the planet, I don't care if it's Bill Gates or Richard Branson, everybody's had setbacks. And if they're unable to learn from that, that's a really, really bad, that's a bad sign.
If I can just add quickly, fail quickly, though. One of the biggest problems I see is people linger on because they don't want to give it up. If it's not working in the marketplace, there comes a time when you just move on.
See, that's just like a relationship.
He said that, not me. He said that.
Fail fast.
Yeah, next question before we dig too deep a hole. I don't know How you guys, yes, go for it. Young lady in the red scarf. Oh, no, the lady standing up, I'm sorry.
Hi, I'm Maria from Canada. I have a question for the whole panel, actually. In 25 years from now, from an entrepreneurial or a creative perspective, what do you see for ISU?
And that's currently one of the design projects, is that right?
Yes. So. You want to jump in, Michael? I mean, you've been long-term vision too.
Do you want me to say something?
Yeah, go for it.
So, you know, and it's a great question. And let me say that when ISU first started out, we talked about it a little bit over with people over lunch and breakfast. I mean, it was an extraordinary thing. It was right in the middle of the Cold War. We wanted a Soviet delegation to come to MIT, which was the heart of all the American technology. We had a Chinese delegation that were coming over. And, you know, the U.S. State Department was very skeptical. They thought this was a terrible idea. They thought there was going to be a lot of problems. And it's truly a miracle that somehow we made this happen. And it wasn't a bunch of enthusiastic, enlightened bureaucrats. I think it was just a lot of stubborn people that just said, hey, this is good. It doesn't seem like a good idea, but trust us, take the leap of faith. It is a good idea. But I think that one of the things that they talked about early on, they talked about a goal of ISU was to have an orbital facility for education. And people thought that was the most science fiction sounding idea that they had ever heard. Like, how can a startup university start talking about an orbital facility? This is 27 years ago. It just didn't make any sense whatsoever. And first of all, the university has stood the test of time. I mean, here we are 27 years later, which is extraordinary. We've had, you know, thousands and thousands of alumni, people running space agencies, people high up in businesses and other government entities. But I think that one of the things is that ISU has had educational sessions from space station, and it's not really a tremendous leap to imagine at some point a full-time facility. And in 2024, there'll be options like Bigelow and other options that are available, and it would make complete sense for some university to rent on a fractional basis an opportunity for that to happen. So I think that almost every single thing that was predicted about the failure of ISU has not come true. So it's a great question to ask, what's next? And I think some of the two most exciting dynamics which governments are going to have a hard time dealing with, I think, are CubeSats that get propulsion, but most importantly, biological payloads that are put on those CubeSats. I think there's a time in the next few years where university students can start to launch life out into the solar system. And I guarantee you, governments haven't figured out what this is all about. They don't know how to regulate it. And I can just tell you that I recently had some genetic testing done, 23andMe. And recently, the Obama administration has outlawed the medical aspects of that. And I can tell you, they waited 7 years before they outlawed the medical aspects of that. And this will be the same thing. People will be launching biology and life into the solar system, and it'll be decades later that the governments finally say, hey, this is strange, this is unusual, what are you doing, is that allowed, who'd you ask? They'll be wondering, like, why didn't the FAA regulate you, why didn't NASA regulate, why didn't the DOD regulate you, why didn't ITAR regulate you? Nobody will even know what to do. It'll take them a decade to deal with it.
Michael, can you tell me what the question was? Something about 25 years, but what?
Well, they want to know ISU. What will ISU look like in 25 years?
Got it. I don't have any immediate answer.
Well, I think, Will, you could maybe talk about singularity and exponentiality. That might have some impact.
I could, but I think a lot of that, you have to take a lot of that with a pinch of salt. I mean, I think the technology is booming. I think we'll see a massive change in education. But as to ISU in general, I mean, I think in 25 years, we should be able to have had permanent settlements off Earth, most in particular on the moon, which is not to get into moon, Mars, but the most obvious place to do it. And when we've established those permanent off Earth settlements, I see very little reason why they won't keep growing in a sort of exponential rate themselves. And at that point, education could be multi-planetary, and that's kind of cool. But I think from a practical learning standpoint, probably the biggest delta is just going to be, I don't know if you guys have heard of startups like Old School, which is really trying to innovate on the education model, and education itself is ripe for disruption, mainly on three key axes: learning how people learn, and teaching people via their interests, teaching people by the method that they are best at learning, like if they're visual learners or what have you, and teaching people at the speed that they can learn. And those three things are probably each add up to a total of an order of magnitude increase to the rate of education. So maybe that means that ISU will happen in a week and have the same level of knowledge sharing and understanding, or maybe it will happen in 10 weeks and be 10 times more understanding at the end of it than it is today. But I see that revolution coming, and that would be pretty exciting too.
And the only other prediction I'd make is that I think there'll be robotic colonies living on the Moon and Mars, and that will be psychologically one of the most powerful points in space exploration in the years ahead.
And if I can make a guess, it'll be in 25 years, younger people will say, why did they bother putting the word space in the name?
Next question.
Hello, I'm Himanshu Patel from India, and I have a question for everybody. Like, in future, what is the role of private industries in the field of like resource mining in space or energy generation in space? Because this field is, I think, it is not touched by government agency, and private industry can really take a leadership role in this field.
So the question, and I think, let me paraphrase this correctly, is that in the future we're looking at resource use of space for resources, for harvesting energy and resources of space. And what is the role of private industry in this?
And planetary resources, I guess.
Yeah.
It's not, you know, my area of expertise, but I'll say that I think we're on the cusp of having the private sector take the lead in utilization of energy off of the planet. Mm-hmm. And I may have some personal issues about the merits of taking valuable resources and returning them to the Earth. What is the business case there? Versus, however, extracting those resources, those minerals, whatever, fuel depots in orbit, and to allow us to go further out. And I think that the role as we move further from the planet will be where you see a traditional role where the government might seek to put in first capital. But clearly, as we're already seeing with planetary resources and the other ventures, once again now in this new era, it's going to be the private sector taking the lead. And I agree completely with what Michael was saying, that a lot of these things, the government will try and catch up in a regulatory environment. They'll try and catch up. But I think the private sector is just going to have a snowball effect. And I see that in a few years, there will be very credible ventures by the private sector in some way extracting something along the lines of energy, whether it's to be used back on the planet or to be used for a lunar colony. I don't know, but I think the private sector will certainly be there.
Actually, if I could just add one other point. You guys touched on policy. I actually think over the next 25 years, I completely agree that that's going to be a really big deal. We basically have a vacuum of space law, if you excuse the pun. It almost doesn't exist. It's like the Wild West, and that's not going to sustain itself. We have problems of orbital space debris. We have problems of planetary protection, and that we have a lot of things to work out, property rights. And I actually don't like the idea of it being a Wild West. The first, like some people on the moon, the Google and XPRIZE teams want to go and land on the moon and then claim ownership of the northern hemisphere of the moon or something. And I'm like, that's just fucking retarded. We don't want them owning the northern hemisphere of the moon. Like, who gives them the right to do that? That doesn't make any sense. So I'd much prefer us to be thoughtful about it. And one of the roles that ISU can play is to really help draft the kinds of reasonable proposition international law that we're going to need for that next phase, and try and do it preemptively.
If I could just add one thing to make a point here. I mean, if you listen to Will, I mean, here we are talking about entrepreneurship. Here we are talking about space, which is a frontier. And yet here is Will saying, like every business person, I want the government involved in some manner.